this is Chucky Roberts reporting live. Reports are coming in of fist-like objects flying over the state.
People are running for cover.
Holy moly!
Don't be afraid. I'm Fred Karger. I'm an independent Republican running for president. My supporters and I are going door to door all over New Hampshire to hear from you.
Hey.
And we'll be giving away these great Fred Frisbees. I want to be your president and bring back the American spirit of optimism and getting along. I'm Fred Karger, and I approve this message.
Ladies and gentlemen, Cleve Jones.
Now, I am not in the habit of endorsing Republicans for any office whatsoever. But I do need to say a word about the man that in my union, and I'm a union guy, we have come to know as Brother Karger. We first called him that somewhat sarcastically when he arrived in San Diego to help my union boycott a big hotel called the Manchester Grand Hyatt because its owner gave $125,000 to put Proposition 8 on the ballot in the first place. It was a little contentious at first, and I thought, what's this Republican guy doing here with this? But Brother Karger launched this boycott, and we've been a great team. And working together, we've now pulled over $10 million in convention business out of that hotel. And, you know, I want you to help him. I really do, because I cannot think of anything better than during those Republican debates. I mean, you're from New Hampshire. You know the attention the state gets. I want to see him on the stage with Romney and all of those other people. I really want to see that. You guys can make that happen, and I want to ask you to do that, please. And he won't let you down. It will be a spectacle, I promise you.
You know, I'm running for president.
For president?
Yes. Yeah, so I heard you say something about president.
Tell me about yourself, then.
So, yeah, check out my website. Hey, you get the right idea. This is the hangout, too.
One time when we were at dinner, he mentioned to us that he had decided to run for president of the United States of America. And at that point, we had always thought Fred was a little unusual, a little crazy perhaps, but this was the time where we really thought, okay, Fred really is just completely nuts.
You're doing what? Fred Karger's running for president? Are you kidding me?
And he just said, I'm running for president. And I thought he was making a joke. You know, president, president of what? And I'm running for president of the United States.
I thought that was great. I thought he added to the campaign that we were all working on to make LGBT people equal, visible, normal, by being part of the dialogue within the Republican Party.
But at the same time, I remember thinking, Fred's crazy enough to actually do this.
Just going over some of the stuff for the press conference. It's Friday, the 9th of April. It's the day before the press conference where I'm going to try and make a little history and talk about being the first openly gay candidate running for president of the United States. I chose this venue because it's the Southern Republican Leadership Conference, the second largest Republican gathering and most prestigious outside of the Republican National Convention.
I love you.
Here with the team, Danielle, who came in from Florida, Kevin, who came in from Los Angeles, Chris Morrow, who's my producer with CNN iReports.
Welcome to New Orleans.
Thanks. Are you ready?
If anyone has any tummy trouble issues, I got some Pepto-Bismol.
One of the first things I did was to read David Plouffe's book about the Obama campaign of 4 years earlier, The Audacity to Win. It really illustrated a long shot candidate's road to the White House.
They've asked me not to hold my press conference. They're allowing everyone else to hold press conferences. I feel that I'm being singled out. So over the weekend, I sent a pretty strong email asking for my First Amendment rights.
You have different fonts going on in here. Fred and I are both activists, and we take the offense in fighting for our rights, and a lot of groups don't do that.
All right, let's get organized here, everybody. Quick team meeting. You're gonna go to the printer. Mm-hmm. We'll go over,
right,
get these two settled.
We work for three presidents on their campaigns, and I have an impeccable record as a Republican, yet they won't allow me a room. So we may have a little battle.
Much of what I did from the very first press conference at the Southern Republican Leadership Conference came from David Plouffe.
We're going to go into the Hilton Riverside.
Okay.
Nothing will be gained unless you take chances. Just roll the dice.
So how y'all doing?
I'm thinking of running for president.
Oh, you are?
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you. So this is the crew.
Sounds good, man. So you promoting yourself today?
Yes, I'm here for the Southern Republican Leadership Conference, but
oh, that's good.
I'm a kind of a different kind of Republican.
Oh, you're a different kind?
I'm an independent Republican. So I'm going to shake it up a little bit here because...
You're going to make it work, right?
And make it work. Bring some people, you know, open up the party as opposed to a lot of others who are trying to exclude people.
That sounds good.
Are you ready for 2012?
America is based on founding documents, and that's the bottom.
Governor Sarah Palin.
When they say, yes, we can, we say, oh, no, you don't.
You know, it's really difficult for a state senator from the state of Louisiana to ask the governor to leave.
Fred who?
Dude, that's me.
Fred, okay.
Excellent.
Excellent.
Making a little history tomorrow.
Yeah.
I'll myself Shirley Chisholm.
Hello, hello. Have you heard about Fred
Thompson?
Oh, close, close. A new Fred.
We enjoy the most conservative state supreme nation.
Hey, this is Fred Karger. I'm doing my first CNN iReport. I'm here at LAX. After a slight delay from my 12-hour ago flight, I'm leaving for Washington, D.C. I'm kicking off kind of my exploratory efforts to see if I may run for president in 2012. My friend Will just drove me to the airport. I'm heading to D.C. for some meetings, and I think I may talk to some people about this, and then I'm going to New York and then New Hampshire. I started this odyssey 6 weeks ago. I went to Washington, D.C. to start a round of meetings.
Condoleezza Rice's office, please.
Yes, I went to the University of Denver with her.
Condi?
I met with the Victory Fund, which is the organization that funds openly gay candidates. I met with HRC. I met with the Republican Majority for Choice, which are the pro-choice Republican women I've been a member of since its inception. Then I went up to New York. That wasn't as fruitful because I was having trouble getting meetings set up. The few meetings I got were canceled. I was pretty discouraged.
It was a huge mountain to climb, and at that point, I pretty much decided against running.
But then I drove with my cousin Dave to Connecticut to his parents' house. His mother is very active after Dave came out.
We had brunch in our dining room. Fred helped me clear, and while we were in the kitchen, that's when he said to me, you know, I'm just not so sure. This is the thing I should be doing right now. And that's when I said, oh, it is, honey, it is. He has that kind of charisma. He's knowledgeable about the system. What better person to come forward and really speak on behalf of the gay community?
And that's why I decided I'm going to stick with my plan, which was to spend a week in New Hampshire testing the waters there. And I did just that.
Hey, this is Fred Karger. I am in New Hampshire. It's my first official day. It's Monday, March 1st, and I'm off to kind of test the waters, or test the snow, I guess, in New Hampshire, and I'll keep you posted along the way.
I rented my Enterprise rent-a-car. I remember the guy picked me up and, you know, what brings you to New Hampshire? I said, well, I think you're ready for president. And he didn't miss a beat. He said, oh, good. Hope you enjoy it. And it was kind of my first indication of the kind of reception that I was going to get for the next 2.5 years.
My name is Fred Karger. I'm crashing your event. I'm from California.
I ended up that night at the University of New Hampshire at the Gay Straight Alliance. And it was a packed room, about 35, 40 kids, mostly all on the floor. And I asked if it would be possible to speak. Absolutely. Get 10 minutes. And I just decided to make it very personal. And I told of my journey to these college students.
I'm what you call a political junkie. I've been gay
You know, since I'm old enough to remember, I was, you know, I had a very, very tough time dealing with it. I'm 60 years old now, but when I was, you know, a teenager and figuring everything out, it was a very different era, and I struggled.
And I think I really struck a nerve. I heard from a tremendous number of these college students, Facebook, emails, and it was the green flag.
And I just listened to Fred's speech about his possible campaign for presidency. I'm really excited about it. I think it would just be an excellent thing to have a gay candidate.
I think it's kind of remarkable that I never even thought of this idea before of a gay president, and it's quite inspirational.
There's so many people, both Democratic and Republican, and as well as independent, who would be willing to support him.
It's crazy to think that I think it's actually quite plausible.
Yeah, I think it's really important to have someone out there and in the front lines for people to look up to and look to as a figurehead.
And I feel it's something that our community needs, and I'm just really excited for 2012.
It was definitely the moment when I made that decision that I was going to run.
I first became aware of Fred Karger because I live in Laguna Beach, which has had a large gay community for a long time, and has one of the oldest gay bars in the Western United States called The Boom. And it's a place that the LGBT community would frequent, and there was dancing and parties and shows, and it was a very fun place to go.
I loved the Boom Boom Room. I loved going there. I loved the camaraderie, you know, being able to come out of my shell. I could be out there. I wasn't out anywhere else in my family life, professional life, or personal life. So it was a good escape.
And it was sold to one of the largest shareholders in AIG.
The Boom was sold to the 83rd richest man in America. He and his wife planned to convert it from a gay bar that it's been for 60 years into a boutique hotel and five-star restaurant.
And Fred Karger was trying to get you to sign a petition to save the Boom.
I've always wanted to be political, but I hadn't done anything up until that point.
Signing up, the excitement's building.
I found that my friendship with Fred was an opportunity that I could get involved.
You know, we're tired of getting shoved around. I'm angry. I'm tired of hiding, and I'm fighting back. And I think a lot of people feel that way.
And I would not sign because I honestly didn't quite trust Fred.
Hey, everybody. Let's all get together. We're going to have a quick meeting right over here by the stoplight.
I was suspect he had an agenda because he'd never been out before. Where did this man come from? And why is he so out now?
Thank you so much for coming.
I learned that he was very high up in the Republican Party in the Reagan administration, and that he was really instrumental in the Willie Horton ad against Dukakis, which was a different political spectrum than I aspired to associate with. I didn't imagine myself ever working with him or associating with him.
I always assumed that Fred was out at that time, and now I know that he wasn't out back then. Going public with his campaign to save the Boom meant that he was going to have to be out to the world on a public level.
Whoa, look at the crowd.
Told you it'd be packed.
Saving the Boom was a huge personal hurdle for me. I hadn't taken that big leap to come out publicly. So as a part of my consideration in going public and trying to save a gay bar in Laguna Beach as a 58-year-old unmarried man, I knew that that would be tantamount to coming out, which I was petrified of.
This is my grandfather, for whom I was named, whose ring I wear.
Oh, he wasn't gay.
Well, his son was, and grandson.
So you have a gay uncle?
Had. He killed himself when I was 21. Very traumatic for me because everybody always compared me to him. You look just like Buddy, you sound just like Buddy, you remind me of Buddy and all that. And then, you know, it turns out I'm gay like Buddy. And I used to see him in the bars, actually, and I would hide. First time I ever went out in Chicago, my uncle's there, my cool bachelor uncle, who supposedly dated, they called them showgirls. You know, like the actresses or something in plays. And oh boy, was that scary. And I hid and fled, and then I would always know, before I would go to the bar, I'd always look to see if his car was there. 46, I think he was, when he did that, so it was devastating. Probably after that is when I started going to three different shrinks to not be gay, and all three were great, luckily, and said, you know, there's nothing we can do, we'll be happy to work with you, but you know, We can't switch. This is in the 70s, early 70s, so you know then it was more common that reparative therapy worked.
You know, I wish he was a Democrat running when Barack Obama wasn't president, but I support him and his work that he's been doing.
We'll definitely start now.
You know, it's interesting because he's basically a community organizer seeking the same kind of change that we're seeking to make the world a better place, especially for LGBT young people who often feel invisible, feel voiceless, and don't see anybody who looks like them or has the same experience leading our country.
I want to make this country a better place. I want to have jobs and opportunity for all of you when you're through high school or through college or whatever direction you go.
Once I came out publicly, I had nothing to hide, which put me in a much better place mentally to take on more important causes that I've since gone into.
When we met, both of us at the time were very devout Mormons.
I was still very much an active member of the Mormon faith, looking to be a good Mormon, but who struggled with same-sex attraction.
We were not looking for boyfriends. We were not interested in breaking what we had been taught to be as commandments of God. This was March 2008. I remember it was a couple of months later when California Supreme Court had just made gay marriage legal. And I'm embarrassed to admit this, but I remember having a conversation that night with Kevin where we talked about how we weren't sure gays should actually be able to get married.
I was still really torn on the subject.
I ran across a link to Californians Against Hate. Californians Against Hate was a website that Fred Karger had created, and online he had posted internal documents from the LDS Church that he had come upon. And these documents detailed very clearly how the LDS Church had, from behind the scenes, orchestrated all of the gay marriage battles, starting in Hawaii, moving on to California with Prop 22. It hurt me so bad because I had not just been loyal to this church, but I had spent 2 years of my life converting people to it. Overnight, I lost my faith.
Fred really brought to national awareness the major funders of the Yes on 8 and showed that it was a national, maybe even larger than that, movement.
And that was a piece of the pattern I did not have, and I was amazed by.
He exposed that this was a thought-out, planned movement to stop equality for LGBT people that came from major institutions that were at least national, if not larger than that.
He says the Mormon Church has lied about the money and the help it gave for Proposition 8.
Now we're fighting back, and everybody's going, oh, you can't do that, this is unfair. Well, that's too bad. We are fighting back.
I realized that Fred really understood very well how the process worked in America.
I started admiring him for his courage. He was very courageous, and I didn't see that in the beginning. I only saw this happy-go-lucky guy saying he signed my petition.
Hey, it's Fred Karger. Day two in New Hampshire. Just wanted to report in. I just left a minute ago the New Hampshire Republican Party offices. Spent about an hour in the office. It was interesting. They didn't know quite what to think of me, but couldn't have been nicer, more hospitable. Had a great meeting, and they gave me a lot of good information about people I should meet with, the demographics. I found out it's pretty easy to get on the New Hampshire ballot. It's just $1,000, and anyone can be on the presidential ballot. You don't even need any signatures.
New Hampshire has this history going back to the 50s of being the first primary in the nation.
Every presidential candidate speaks in here.
Uh-huh.
So something for you to think about. We will hold 15 to 20 debates in this room.
Wow. They are so used to presidential campaigns and candidates.
Hey, this wrong ring.
That it is a full-time sport there.
They have Fenway Park down in Boston. We have this place.
When did it move to the earlier first in the nation?
Well, we have a law in New Hampshire that says that we have to be first. And so each time somebody moves ahead, we move ahead. And part of our charge here is to protect that primary.
What they particularly relish are the candidates that come in and do the grassroots campaigning.
Running for president 2012?
That really pound the pavement.
You don't need a lot of money to campaign. In fact, money is sometimes a turnoff to people.
Are you old enough for a Frisbee?
It was the perfect fit for Fred Karger because it's a small state that is much more libertarian. It's much more receptive to a moderate voice.
If you love politics, this is the place to do it.
Well, my name's Fred Karger. I'm give you these stickers.
People will hear you out.
I want to open the flaps of the tent and let everyone in.
Yeah.
thinking of running for president in 2012.
Hey, can I give you one of my cards? I'm Fred Karger. I'm thinking of running for president in 2012.
Where are you guys? You guys?
We're from the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints.
How's it going? Have you been
knocking door to door, talking to people on the street like yourself?
Have you seen Mitt Romney yet?
I've never seen Mitt Romney.
Oh.
I only know Steve Young.
So one of the things that was in my strategy was to spend an inordinate amount of time in New Hampshire to really get to know the people.
Hey, thanks, guys.
Logo's too small. And the color's not in the background.
My first goal was to be taken seriously as a Republican candidate for president.
The whole background of the plate is more of a blue-green. This is just a dark green. That's the other problem.
The irony is when people first meet me, they don't think of me as a serious guy, which is a huge hurdle.
Why was I furious when these things arrived? We spent 6 weeks working on these t-shirts, design and the colors and this whole thing back and forth and the printers and the bids and everything. And then I was all excited. Bam. This is turquoise color screaming out at me.
And so everything I did had to fit that definition. I wanted to make sure I was dignified. And that was an overall theme I had.
This is one of my main emphasis here in New Hampshire is going to be this Fred Who on the license plate. I'm going to do notepads, and that's going to kind of be my theme for the state. So this exploratory trip is very important that everything look right. In the early stages of a campaign, so much what people see are t-shirts and the pins.
Any self-respecting presidential candidate these days has to wear a flag lapel pin.
Right.
I went online, of course, and looked. It's like rainbow flag, American flag, rainbow flag, and this appeared. A combo. Here we go.
We're going to be heading up to Hanover to Dartmouth. I'm giving a speech at Dartmouth Gay Pride, which I'm very honored to speak at. There are all these great, great interstates here. Somebody must have had a lot of influence to get all this money.
We got another 1.8 miles before South Park Street, and we're going to be turning a right on that, I believe.
Part of my campaign, I'm going to be talking to the gay-straight alliances at the different colleges and universities, because this is the group of activists whom I want to really engage in this campaign. And Rigel has set up a meeting for me.
That's Webster Avenue, which we call Frat Row.
And it's going to be at the Rockefeller Center. And as a Rockefeller Republican, it has particular significance. We got some giveaways, too. We got some t-shirts and pins. I got the new pins.
It's with great honor that we welcome Fred Karger to Dartmouth College. Karger's political career spans nearly four decades. In 2008, he started Californian Against Hate, a grassroots effort to boycott the four major donors of Prop 8. It's with great excitement and pride that I ask us to welcome Fred Karger.
Thank you very much, Rigel. Why, in the back of my mind, why would I come up with this crazy idea? Why, never having run for office, you know, why not start at school board? It's, as I call it, it was kind of a perfect storm. And 42% of the voters here in New Hampshire are independent. And they're independent for a reason. They've left both parties. They're dissatisfied. Well, I want to appeal to independents. I mean, that is basically my philosophy. I've stuck with the Republican Party because, again, I'm a fighter, I'm stubborn, and I hope to change it and open it up. But I'm going to be trying to really expand this base, and it's going to be through two things. One is to bring younger people into the campaign and have it fun and energetic. And the other thing is going to be a massive voter registration program. I want to get big voter registration efforts underway. That's the important thing to do now. And again, as a political person, we have to look to the future. Lee, nice to meet you.
Callie.
Fred Karger.
Sean.
How do you do?
Hi, Fred. I'm Good
to meet the audience. Oh, hey.
I've been really passionate about politics since I was, 12 years old. My dad worked for President Reagan, so I'd had a knowledge of politics and government. You know, politics just became something that was extremely exciting for me, and I wanted to get involved. But being gay in politics just wasn't possible. It wasn't realistic. So I said, okay, I either want to be a politician or I want to come out. You know, I just knew that for me, coming out and being true to myself was the most important thing. So I came out when I was 14. I came out to my family, to my friends, and, for a while there, I thought, I'll just try to find something else, find another way of making a difference. But then I thought, just in the same way that Shirley Chisholm broke the barrier for African Americans and women back in the 70s, I knew, you know, someone will come along and help blaze that trail for me and for the other kids out there that want to make a difference. I was pretty proactive about it. When I was 14, I wrote a letter to Tammy Baldwin's office, and it was actually an email. I sent her office an email, and I said, you know, I know that you're a member of Congress, I know that you're probably busy with that, but, you know, I want you to know how meaningful it would be for a young gay kid like me and for all the gay kids out there to see somebody from their own community who actually had the platform to run for president and be an example for, you know, the youth out there to give them hope. So I sent the email off, I didn't hear anything back, but 2 years later I was a page in Washington for the summer and I had the opportunity to meet Tammy Baldwin and have a photo opportunity with her. And so I walked up to her and I shook her hand and I said, you know, it's an honor to meet you, Congresswoman. And I mentioned who I was, I said my name, and she went, well, wait a second, aren't you the same James Mason who wrote that letter to me a couple years ago about running for president? And I was like, I couldn't believe it. You know, she didn't say that she was gonna run for high office, but, you know, I knew that was in her sights. So that solidified that desire within me to see that happen, whether it was her or anybody else. I knew that when that happened, it would be a really important and meaningful thing for me. And out of the blue, I was reading the Advocate's website. It was late 2010, and I saw that there was an openly gay candidate for president. That sort of came out of nowhere. All of a sudden, the thing that had been for so long an abstract idea for me, something that, you know, would eventually happen one day, you know, it was actually happening. It was a reality, and I was so excited to see that Fred Karger was actually going to be that example to help blaze the trail and advance the cause for gay youth.
I feel like about 3 feet off the ground as I was signing the form, turning it in, getting it stamped. I mean, it's a dream I've had, I guess, my whole life.
I guess I've been a frustrated candidate ever since I was probably 15, 16 years old. I've always kind of wondered, you know, what it would be like to be the candidate as opposed to the handler. So this experience is very personal. As someone who's worked in politics for so long, who's always wanted to run but never could, I thought, because I was gay.
Hi, Fred Karger for Washington Unplugged.
I've always been the groomsman, never the groom. And so it's an interesting experience. I can finally live my dream, which is to run for office. You know, I'm starting at the highest office in the land. So I'm very lucky to be in this position where I could do this.
Got a very special interview today with Fred Karger, who's done a lot of campaign work for former Republican presidents, but's here today with a very special announcement, Fred. What's the news?
I just left the Federal Election Commission office at 999E, and I submitted my paperwork. I filed to run for president of the United States.
You would be the first openly gay president of the United States. Why do you think that's important?
I've dedicated today to the 6 younger people, teenagers who committed suicide last fall, joining thousands of others who've done that because they've been bullied for being different. And I want to talk about that. The fact that I can have, be able to discuss, you know, this is a first. I would be the first openly gay candidate, mm-hmm. I am now, to ever run for president of a major political party. Mm-hmm. And it opens the door. It's something that Shirley Chisholm did in 1972 as the first African-American to run for president and opened the door for Jesse Jackson and President Obama. And I want to do that for my community.
I just think it's so cool. I'm totally about his message, reaching out to the LGBT community across the whole nation, to the youth, to letting them know that there is hope.
I'm in Washington because I love politics. I'm just trying to get as much experience as possible. And when you can have experience in politics with people who are as close to your morals and values and your ideology, that's like cake. So I'm eating cake right now. I like it.
Sitting with Rena and Matt, the significance of what I was doing became very real to me. I no longer had to say that I was seriously considering running. I was now officially running for President of the United States.
Gay Republican is first to challenge Obama.
It really hit me.
and I was determined to represent my community, a faction of the Republican Party I've been fighting to preserve, and my country. As I went off to New Hampshire from there, I suddenly had a very different feeling about what I was doing.
Hey, it's Fred. I am back in New Hampshire, and I'm ready to kick it up a notch and rock and roll.
We gotta figure out how to get to the margaritas.
Do you have an address for it?
I do.
77 Main Street.
It's the first town hall meeting of the 2012 season.
I was very apprehensive that day driving to Keene. I didn't know if anyone would show up. I thought it might be just the three of us in the car.
The definition of a town hall meeting is a candidate who is seriously considering running for office holds any kind of meeting with a group of possible supporters or just interested New Hampshireites who suddenly speaks for a few minutes and takes Q&A. And that is a town hall meeting, and this is my first. Hello, hello.
Hi,
I'm Fred.
I'm Susan.
You are. Good to meet you. The voice on the
phone. No, not Susan McNeil. She's the other Susan.
Susan McNeil. Okay.
This is the other Susan. Wonderful to see you.
Nice to meet you. Thank you so much. Yeah. This is so great. This is a cute place.
Isn't it great?
Very excited to have Fred. Ken.
Fred, this is Jared.
Hi, how are you?
How do you do? Fred,
hi, Jared. Nice to meet
you. Nice to meet you.
Elise.
Sorry.
You guys take it
great. Are you Keene residents?
Yes, we're from Keene. We're Keeners.
Brother and sister?
No. No, she's a family friend.
Oh, okay. I don't know. No, I'm trying to be a politician. Mario.
Oh, that's nice.
You?
I am Jamie Comtois. I run a local nonprofit in the community, and I've been tracking the fact that Rick Santorum was coming tomorrow night to Keene.
Okay, that was the right reaction.
So anyway, I wondered if your visit tonight had anything to do with the fact that Rick's going to be the keynote at the Republican Cheshire County dinner tomorrow night.
No, it's coincidence. I'm here for Cleve Jones.
Okay.
For our agents, our 20th anniversary.
Okay. He's my hero, services. Not Rick Santorum.
Okay. I was...
What an egg. I knew I liked this man.
Hi, Becky.
Becky, Fred.
Okay. I work in home health care.
You do? All right.
Kim May, home health care.
Home health care, all right.
Oh, and home health care also. I want to include that job.
This is incredible. There are a lot of people here. I was so impressed with the turnout, particularly because I'd heard that when John McCain first ran for president in 2000, here's a sitting United States senator, very well known at the time, he gave away cupcakes and he only had 19 people. We had 50 people. Of course, we had free margaritas.
You're welcome.
Everybody, free t-shirts all around. Yeah. By size. They're 100% cotton. Are you allergic to cotton?
No.
Okay,
no,
good.
Not at all.
All right, we got to get these guys doing a little Fred Who advertising.
There you go.
Brad has the upbringing, the education, the look. He knows how to speak. He's been in the system. And I think that's the right person right now to push the envelope. I think that's smart.
Yeah, guy trips me. Trips me. Is there a doctor in the house?
Yeah, man.
This is the Keene State?
Yeah.
Hey, I'm Fred Karger.
Zach,
good to meet you.
So Republicans are going to pay attention to him. White men are going to pay attention to him because he is one of them.
Jeez.
And yet in his heart and who he is someone who does not stick to convention.
Hey, great to meet you.
And by him having the package of the way he looks, the way he talks, his experience, his connections.
I'm a gay guy who can run for president.
He is a good vehicle to know how to move our agenda forward that's outside of the larger LGBT organization.
If some of these Republicans want to start attacking our community, I'm going to be in their face.
It was a very diverse crowd across party lines, gender, age. It was a good cross-section of Keene, New Hampshire, and I was really impressed that such a wide array of people turned out to meet me.
Thank you so much for coming. If there are any questions, be happy to take a couple. I know you want to get back.
Yankees or Red Sox?
That's a very good question.
She's
a Cubs fan.
Oh.
I went to one Red Sox game, and it was the highest scoring playoff game in history. They beat Cleveland 23-6.
It was just so fascinating to see these voters of New Hampshire come to Fred, who might be in a party that they've never thought they would vote for, with such an open mind, and let him into their hearts.
Oh yeah, that's perfect. More? That's good, that'd be great on Twitter.
Wow, that was exciting. I think I'm onto something. The gay community has never had a voice before, particularly in presidential politics. The excitement, which is unique here in New Hampshire, because this is such a political state, is just ready to explode. I see it. I've just been getting nothing but tremendous response from people.
The other go-to state for any respectable candidate running for president is Iowa.
Thank you very much. Glad to have you here.
It has a huge amount of importance because it is the first caucus in the nation. So every single candidate has to go in there.
Senator, Fred Karger. Hi, how are you?
Good.
Can I get a quick picture?
Sure.
Ready?
Wonderful.
People misunderstand Iowa. They don't think we're quite into issues, but Iowa was anti-slavery some 50 years before the federal government.
I'm Fred Karger. I'm looking to run for president in 2012.
Iowa allowed women to vote before they were allowed federally.
Over here is the Supreme Court. Now, that's where the unanimous vote just a little over a year ago brought marriage equality to Iowa.
One of our past slogans is it's a surprising place.
I knew that I would be of interest there because it's a gay marriage state like New Hampshire, that they would be a little more hospitable to the first openly gay candidate.
Hi, Fred, how are you doing? Nice to see you.
Hey, I'm Fred Karger.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, too.
And I knew if I went in there, I would also get attention because they're very interested in the presidential candidates.
I'll tell you, I've gotten just a great, great reaction. Most people, you know, have been super friendly. Everyone's from Iowa.
Are you finding people have heard of you when they come meet you?
Well, I'm still Fred Who.
This year, when you look through the million visitors at the Iowa State Fair, you can see Fred.
I'm still Fred Who.
Fred Who is Fred Karger, a Californian who might run for president. He's here to show Iowans he's not your typical Republican. For one, he's gay.
I guess I'm disappointed, and particularly having worked for Ronald Reagan in some of his campaigns, you know, he lit a fire under the country.
Now Rick, another lesser-known candidate, lights that fire under his spatula. Former Pennsylvania Senator Rick Santorum wants to be included at the table of 2012 possibilities. So he took the traditional must-stop spot around the Iowa Pork Producers Grill.
I'll make a decision, you know, later this year, in part based on the feedback I get from people here in Iowa.
Sometimes cooking that chop is easier than the name game. Just ask the man Santorum grilled with the past hour.
As a matter of fact, this last gentleman, I had no idea who he was.
So, Dave, really the response from a lot of people at the fair is, who? Who are you?
Who? Yeah, and you saw Fred Karger actually going around with those T-shirts that said Fred Who, embracing the fact that nobody knows who he is, but he thinks he has plenty of time to get you to know who he is.
I'm Fred Karger. I'm looking to run for president in 2012.
And so I was very excited about campaigning in Iowa.
Who wants pork?
I hired a state director, Nathan Treloar, great experience in Republican politics there, and run many campaigns, had worked for the state Republican Party.
The way I like to describe it is that, you know, if you have to go to court, you get a lawyer. Well, if you wanted to do something in politics, you'd call a guy like me.
And so he was my eyes and ears and did everything for me, and it was very well received. I just returned to California when I late at night got an email from someone that I'd never heard of by the name of Steve Scheffler. And he had said that he was the Republican National Committeeman for Iowa, which is one of the top two Republican officials in the state, and that he was going to work overtime to abort my candidacy, that I was a homosexual radical, and that we were not welcome in Iowa, and he was going to do everything to hurt my campaign. And it was a kick in the stomach for me.
Reading that, it was inflammatory. It was the kind of thing that I've, you know, always hated to see from any elected official, but, you know, especially Republican officials, because it just gives everybody such a terrible name and makes all Republicans look like a bunch of bigots and hate mongers.
It really hurt because this is a Republican Party that I've been very active in and involved with, and just because I happen to be gay, this man never even met me, he took that attack.
The word he literally used was abort your chances here in Iowa.
I thought about that long and hard before I realized that I need to expose that, that that is why I'm running for president. I want to flush out the Steve Schefflers of the world, the people that are that spew that kind of hate. And it actually turned into a great campaign opportunity because it became a very big news story, not just in Iowa. The Des Moines Register broke it, but it went national. And he never apologized or anything, but everyone else did.
And we started getting all of this email from people that have read the story that were, you know, supportive of our side of the issue.
They said how this is not the way we operate in Iowa. Everyone is welcome here, which was a great personal satisfaction area for me, but it also sent a message that homophobia is not going to be allowed in 2012 in the presidential campaign in Iowa. It led to an email I got from a guy named Jan Michelson, who is the most revered talk show host in Iowa.
Welcome back to The Conversation. I'm Jan Michelson. We're broadcasting live from the Iowa State Fair. We have a chance to meet Fred Karger this morning. He is the gay rights boogeyman of the GOP presidential race. He was described that way.
Jan's actually what we consider an icon on our station. Whether you like him or dislike him, you tune in to either yell at him or love him.
What was it? One of the local Christian-based organizations said, hey, you're not welcome here in the Republican Party. Who was that?
Well, yeah, the Republican National Committeeman Steve Scheffler sent me a pretty threatening email about a month ago and told me I was not welcome in Iowa because I am gay and that he would work overtime to abort my candidacy.
Okay.
This is a man that is very conservative who has spoken out at anti-gay marriage rallies.
I reject the concept of gay. I'm not a heterosexual. I'm a guy.
Uh-huh.
You're a guy. It's a scam invented in the 50s by Kinsey.
What I tried to create was to just be human and be pleasant and respectful. But I told him pain that Steve Scheffler caused me and brought back all the hate and fear I had growing up. It really was a definitive moment for me. We became friends, and I was on his show six more times.
Do that again?
What's he doing there?
You know, I grew up as the son of a Reaganite, so I'd always had an appreciation for the Republican Party, or at least what it used to be. Up until the late 80s, when the extreme conservative wing of the party took over.
There is a religious cultural war going on in this country, as critical to the kind of nation we shall be as the Cold War itself, but this war is for the soul of America.
So to see somebody come along, not just on gay rights, but on other issues, you know, just generally, to offer a more moderate and sensible approach, I think that was a really meaningful thing.
When I started this, I said my theme is bringing back the American spirit, and I define that as optimism and getting along.
You know, so Fred's contribution was not just on gay rights. His contribution was sending out the message that if the Republican Party wants to compete and, you know, move into the 21st century as a party, then it needs to moderate itself and it needs to open itself up to, you know, to minority communities.
You got 10 bottles of vodka?
10 bottles of vodka, and that's it for alcohol thus far.
We're having a Ronald Reagan centennial birthday party tonight. It's a cocktail party commemorating my old boss's 100th birthday. Crashing CPAC, the Conservative Political Action Conference. I had to go rent my own room. They wouldn't allow me to be in the exhibition hall even. They wouldn't allow me to speak, and they didn't put me on the straw poll.
A group called the Traditional Values Coalition was sending out an email to all the representatives and members saying, you know, your family members, your children should have a great time at CPAC, but they should know that there will be parties and that there will be predators out there, especially the radical homosexual predators.
You know, they should be categorized hate groups. I've been through dozens of political campaigns, so I know the ups and downs of the business, but this was about me, and it was about being the first openly gay candidate. And I know that a lot of the rejection I got was solely because of that.
I just called a bit ago. I've got a big sheet cake for this evening that's gonna say happy birthday Ronald Reagan on it.
Hi, I have a reservation for a suite today and I'd like to see if I could check in early.
R-E-A-G-A-N.
It's under Karger, K-A-R-G-E-R.
CPAC is an annual event in Washington, D.C. every February. And it's a must-go-to event for Republican candidates for president.
Checking in?
Yeah, for our suite. We have a suite.
Sure, come on in.
Okay.
Fred Karger, I'm in Washington, D.C. D.C. at CPAC, the Conservative Political Action Conference. I had read 2 months ago that any self-respecting Republican candidate for president for 2012 would be at CPAC, so I'm here.
It's a must-go-to event because of the ability to meet 10,000 activists.
Atlas Shrugged movie today.
To speak.
We, the people, tell the government what to do.
And, more importantly, about 3,000 journalists that cover the event.
Got our invitations. We're going to go up to the media room and hand it out.
I'm the guy that they shut out of CPAC. I was the guy that kept out of CPAC. They wouldn't give me a booth or put me on the straw poll because I happen to be gay. I was excluded from CPAC, first openly gay candidate. I'm openly gay. It's a little sensitive on the whole gay thing.
How do you justify working so hard for a party that has been so objectionable to who you are personally?
Well, yeah, some would consider a gay Republican an oxymoron. But I'm not a moron. I want to put a face on the gay community, and I want to send a message to younger people in this country. You can do anything you want to do. You can even run for president of the United States.
Fred doesn't fit the stereotype that Republicans like to paint of gays.
Good catch.
We're just like everybody else, and we want to be treated just like everybody else. And having somebody like Fred who's doing what he's doing is going to increase the visibility of who we are.
It puts a face on the gay community that many Americans have never seen before.
Keep up the good work. It'd
be great to have you in the debate.
I really think that the message Fred is bringing is something that we're going to see more and more throughout America.
Frisbee! Ooh. Hey, good catch!
If you can't beat him, throw a party. And we did.
It's been quite an ordeal. I'm tired, but I'm recharged. I'm heading up to New Hampshire Wednesday. You know, I stumbled on the Centennial in Concord just by chance on the internet, and this has been my home since February for at least a month. I've been here about a week at a time.
And I just love the history of this place. My first night here, I went to the bar, and I found out this was Hillary Clinton's headquarter hotel. They were filling me in with stories of Bill at the bar and how he would go around glad-handing everyone, and Hillary, she'd sit at the bar.
This room here is the governor's suite. This is where Hillary Clinton stayed when she was in our hotel. It has 3 flat-screen TVs. It's almost like a live-in apartment minus the kitchen.
I was pretty moved. It was fun. It was a little smaller than I expected. I sat at the table, had a couple pictures taken. Gave me a little chill, I guess, knowing the history, not just in this hotel, but particularly in that suite.
I can just imagine Bill, you know, passed out in one room, Hillary frantically all night long with Patty Solis Doyle, figuring out how they can inch ahead of Obama.
Firing her campaign manager, rehiring her campaign manager, Bill running around.
And then what must have been a monumental excitement the night after Hillary's primary win in New Hampshire, going back to that suite and celebrating.
So just being in this hotel and on that same floor is very exciting for me.
Well, that sounds great. I look forward to it. Thank you very much for the invite. I'll try and be a white male conservative progressive.
I decided, based on a rigorous campaign schedule, needed a little vacation, and what better place to do it than in New Hampshire. So we headed north, and on our way up, we stopped for lunch with Kevin's parents.
Fred Karger. I'm Bob.
Bob and Jean.
Both love you, Bob.
They had a beautiful lunch by the lake. It was just spectacular. The nicest people. And were treating me like I was already elected president. After lunch, it was time to head to our destination. Lake Winnipesaukee is a famous resort in the lakes of New Hampshire. And so we spent a few days there on a working vacation. It's also the home to Mitt Romney.
A lot of people ask where Mitt Romney's house is. That's his boathouse with the eyebrow window on it. It's like a 12-acre piece, and then there's equestrian outfit for his wife and kids are in there too.
Has it been in his family a long time, or?
No, he built it.
Oh, he built?
He was only built the last couple of years.
Yeah.
I got to thinking, where is he registered to vote? He has this $15 million state he's got there right on the lake. He's got another $15 million home on the ocean in La Jolla, California. He had said he was going to register his son's home in Belmont, Massachusetts to vote for Scott Brown during the Senate election. Living in his son's home, you can't register to vote in your son's house. It has to be your principal residence. The next stop was to go to Belmont, Massachusetts and see the house he'd lived in for all the years that he sold. We asked a lot of questions. Where does Mitt Romney really live? I went to the local fish market and asked the owner there. He said, I haven't seen Mrs. Romney in 2 years. They moved to California. And then we went to the Mormon temple and asking a few parishioners there, and they said, we haven't seen him here in over 2 years. They'd moved to California. So it became a pattern, and I filed formal charges with the elections official and the tax official in the state of Massachusetts to determine where his residency was, because very serious charge as far as voter registration goes.
Joining us now is Republican Fred Karger. How serious do you think this is as a potential violation? Why are you going out of your way to bring these allegations to light?
I think it really points to Mitt Romney's character. You know, he's changed his position so often from 1994 when he ran against Senator Edward Kennedy to the 2008 primaries. He's just completely flip-flopped on everything.
What is motivating you here? It sounds like that, from what I know of your campaign, you've been involved in different sides of Republican politics for a very long time, but you've made this decision this year that you are going to run for president. And I don't mean to cast aspersions on your likelihood of actually achieving the nomination, but if you don't get the nomination, what are you hoping to achieve with your candidacy?
I want to make a Republican Party that's much more inclusive, that's not so far right. I want to have the Republican Party I grew up with, Theodore Roosevelt and Dwight Eisenhower, and people who are inclusive and caring, and I want to bring younger people into this party and make it a real force, but reflect the independence of this party and the independence of this country where most people are moving.
I knew getting into this, the only way I could ever have a chance for success was to be in a debate. And my goal was to get in one Republican primary presidential campaign debate, which was a stretch for a first-time candidate.
Now let's meet the candidates. Congressman Ron Paul of Texas, who is currently serving his 12th term in Congress. Herman Cain, former chairman and CEO of Godfather's Pizza and radio talk show host.
The first debate of the season is in Greenville, South Carolina. You had to be on the primary ballot in order to get in the debate. $25,000 fee, they'll let anybody on the primary ballot, but that did not translate to being on the stage in that debate. You had to be at 1% in 5 national polls. Unfortunately, I'd only been in one poll at the time, which showed me at 1%. So I knew that I had to get 4 other polls that showed me at 1% or higher in order to get in subsequent debates. Well, then it moved up to New Hampshire, to St. Anselm's College.
This is St. Anselm's College. Just 3 months ago, I was the winner of the straw poll that was held at the New Hampshire Institute of Politics.
Fred Karger received 79 votes. Mitt Romney received 74 votes. Donald Trump received 26 votes.
I had won the straw poll there just a few months earlier, where I beat Mitt Romney and Donald Trump, even, who was in the contest at the time.
Congratulations, Mr. Karger, on the win.
I thought I was in a pretty good position.
It's a happy night for me. I just won the first New Hampshire straw poll. St. Anselm College Republican, the largest straw poll of this cycle. I just beat Mitt Romney by a percentage point and a half, 24.5% to 23%.
But they established such difficult criteria, it eliminated many of the candidates, and I was unable to get in.
Fred, did they let you in?
Unfortunately, I just missed. I was 1 percentage point away from being invited.
Back to California, Fred. You're not in the debate.
Okay, thanks.
Back to California, Fred.
They had a criteria they set up, which I didn't think was particularly fair. They upped it from the earlier criteria that was held in the Fox debate. I'm feeling a little upset, particularly as an openly gay candidate.
This question stirred up a whole lot of controversy online. It comes from Stephen Hill, who is a soldier serving in Iraq.
In 2010, when I was deployed to Iraq, I had to lie about who I was because I'm a gay soldier, and I didn't want to lose my job. My question is, under one of your presidencies, do you intend to circumvent the progress that's been made for gay and lesbian soldiers in the military?
The fact that he could ask this question, Stephen Hill, who was fighting our enemies in Iraq,
as an out gay soldier, it was just hugely significant, and he got booed. You do not boo members of the military. One of those 11 candidates, all of those 11 candidates should have blasted those people.
Senator Santorum?
And it went right to Rick Santorum.
I would say any type of sexual activity has absolutely no place in the military, and the fact that they're making a point to include it as a provision within the military that we are going to recognize a group of people and give them a special privilege and removing don't ask, don't tell, I think tries to inject social policy into the military.
Rick Santorum, devout Catholic, he was uncomfortable with the question, and that's what happens. He'll say something inappropriate.
What we're doing is playing social experimentation with our military right now, and that's tragic. I would just say that going forward, we would reinstitute that policy if Rick Santorum was president.
I promise you, had I been on that stage, I would have chastised those booers and asked for an apology. That was a very definitive moment for me because I realized that is why I'm in this race.
I'm the guy they left out.
Sorry, people got left out.
And then the next debate, another Fox News debate, I met the requirements. I was at the 5-poll threshold of 1% or higher in each of those polls. So I appealed to Fox News, and I basically sent a letter to the organizer and said, we've made it, here's the results, where do I show up? Well, that didn't work. They slammed the door. And so I did what I had done before. I filed a formal complaint with the Federal Election Commission because I was not treated fairly. I was treated separately from the other candidates. I legitimately met their criteria, but they would not allow me in that debate.
It's a catch-22. In order to get into the debate, you need to be in the polls, and in order to be registering the polls, you need to be in the debates. We're seeing it. I mean, Herman Cain is my strategy exactly. In a very mediocre field, he's got some pizzazz and personality, and he stood out.
Hello, I'm Herman Cain. I am not a politician. I am a problem solver with over 40 years of business and executive experience.
Had I been in that debate, and had I shined at all, which was my whole strategy, as we saw through these other debates, there'd be a breakout candidate quite often, and I was a fresh face, and certainly much more of a centrist than any other candidate running, I could have certainly been catapulted into a 2-digit polling numbers, and who knows what would have happened.
A lot more ground to cover with our candidates tonight. We're about to take our first break.
And I knew at that point that I would never again reach those thresholds, because now we've had 3 debates, these candidates had much higher name ID, and we're doing better in the polls, and I was kind of left in the dust. Things were looking very bleak, and I was very discouraged. My whole goal had been to get into a debate, and that had now passed me by. If there was ever a good reason for me to drop out of the race, this was it.
I will work hard, and don't ask, don't tell.
It would be very easy to think that no one was paying attention. But I decided to just forge ahead, give it my all, and something good would happen. Suddenly things started to turn around. People were starting to pay more attention.
The U.S. has its first openly gay candidate from a political party, a major political party.
Fox News is barring this man from its Republican presidential debate simply because he is gay.
And it reinvigorated the campaign.
Welcome back to Harville. We have Fred Karger. He's running for the Republican presidential nomination even as we speak.
You are a relative unknown to many. A lot of people may just be hearing your name right now.
Republican Fred Karger, who is the first openly gay candidate for president of the United States.
After this long journey, we're on the cusp of the first primary in the country in New Hampshire.
This marks the spot where I began this journey 22 months ago. I'm campaigning. Presidential candidate Fred Karger. Might not hurt me, so he'd go by Fred who? Hey, you guys get one of my cards? I'm a presidential candidate.
I dove into New Hampshire in a big way.
Are you a candidate?
I'm a presidential candidate, Fred Karger.
Oh.
Bearing gifts.
Good luck.
Thank
good
you.
Luck.
Fred who?
Fred's candidacy makes me feel like anything is possible, whether it's running for Congress, running for Senate, running for governor, running for president.
And you're a handsome man.
Well, thank you. You might need a new prescription in your glasses, I think.
Fred Karger keeps coming up with really smart, creative strategies to help the equality for all movement.
And we got stickers, too. Anybody like stickers? That way you can go right to my website.
Rented a house. We called the New Hampshire White House. Great big 7-bedroom house that we worked out of and lived in.
I support Fred!
We had lawn signs all over the state. We even went up to Dixville Notch, which is the city that holds the first election vote, and talked to a few voters up there.
Primary, you know, is next Tuesday here. It's only 8 days away.
I've spent all my time there and all my waking hours campaigning.
I wish you the best.
Thank you so much.
It was a very exciting time to realize that I was one of the 12 leading candidates running for president on the Republican side.
So it's going well?
It's going really well.
He can tell the stories that need to be told. I believe that he'll go down in history as a gay man that accomplished a lot.
Fred Karger, 2012!
Wow!
What I was really reminded of as I traveled over the entire country for 2.5 years was the distance we still have to go.
There's an openly gay Republican running for president.
I haven't heard any of this, and I'm very happy I haven't.
70% of the country still lives in states that don't allow gay marriage.
He did so much for explaining to our community how Prop 8 went wrong.
And so many other people, young and old.
Hey, Fred Karger!
That I met during this journey remind me of how far we have to go.
We just had someone walk in, and he's not supportive of emphasizing that Fred might be the first openly gay candidate.
Threw me a punch.
I hope I made some difference in speeding that timetable up.
A new chapter in American history begins today.